Now, here I am doing something I said I'd never do. Make a video of people I don't care about, don't like, and on an issue of no possible interest to anyone other than press agents, lawyers, and sad sex, really. The life and misfortunes of Jeffrey Epstein and Ghislaine Maxwell. In their own way, sad, pathetic, and repulsive. Well, certainly Jeffrey was to me. Surely best kept off-air, along with cat videos, those unboxing films, nature captures. Don't watch nature documentaries. Go out there yourself. Maybe places you can't go, but immerse yourself in that. Oh, and just about every video on Facebook that tricks viewers into a long wait with no payoff. They just want the timing, you see. But on the other hand, since I have a perfect opportunity to just about offend everyone, the supposed perpetrators, prosecutors, the judges in courtland, and you judges in Wonderland, it is an opportunity too good to pass up. And if my remarks derail a courtroom trial, well, I can only try. Hello, David McMillan here. My fellow YouTube self-flagellator, Sean Atwood, he ran hundreds of Jeffrey Epstein videos with many viewers tuning in. I had no idea why. I don't think I watched one of them. Epstein was, in case you happen to have been living on the moon for the last few years, a New York City-based high-end company stock fund manipulator, once valued at over $1 billion. My own guesstimate is closer to $150 million in liquid assets, and liquid assets are the only ones that count. He cultivated Tony contacts and massaged investors' greed to skim millions. Yes, I mean that loner oddball with the oversized head, a lumpy head, short legs, and a louche, sloppy mouth. A touch of a lisp there, if you listen. I'll put a video on here.
I'm Jeffrey Edward Epstein, and my residence address is 6100 Red Hook Boulevard in Virgin Islands.
Do you maintain any other residences presently?
I have vacation homes in New Mexico, Palm Beach, New York, and Paris.
Characteristics, by the way, that almost guarantee a pervert. I've seen that kind of body shape writhing along many jail corridors, and a quick check of the files has found a hidden sex crime or two, for sure. And judging a book by the cover? Well, yes, actually, that's the whole point of the cover, to alert the reader as to what's inside. We are, like it or not, as nature shapes us. We are our shape. Anyway, Sean's Epstein videos drooled into a pedo hunt, and no good comes of making oneself an anti-pedo activist. It's like joining the search team for the body of the strangled vicar, and the next minute you're suspect number one. Sean nearly lost his channel forever down to that. But I'm no activist. An anti-activist, if anything. I don't believe in any activity other than, well, a full breakfast followed by an even fuller day's sleep. Besides, no one gets hot under the collar about my little channel. It drifts on by. Yet there are two things worth understanding about this Epstein-Maxwell shrugfest. Number one, just what a lame example of sex criminal he is. Epstein was an incredibly low-level amateur runner-up in the pervert stakes. I can tell you, I've had more threatening and forceful sickos from troop leaders in the Boy Scouts. Some of those small-town volunteers tried their best to show 8-year-old David how to slip on a scarf tie, I can tell you. And second, I'll soon point this out, The Ghislaine Maxwell trial is a farce of a mockery of a sham, almost not quite a travesty. Maybe this is not the video for Woody Allen references here, but the prosecution paints Ghislaine somehow as, I don't know, assistant agent 99 to Jeffrey Epstein's Maxwell Smart. His not-so-glamorous assistant is currently under trial in a New York district court on federal charges of conspiring to entice minors to travel to engage in illegal sex acts. Now, that sounds technical, and it is. They had to word it that way to get it through, that somebody had done something. And it's conspiracy, and I've spoken of that before. Epstein had been refused bail, due, it seems, to having an expired Canadian passport in his safe with his picture pasted in. And he was later found dead in his cell, as most people know. The offered cause? Suicide. The official cause. Conspiracy fans suggest a murder. Why? To keep him from naming big names, of course. Yet Jeffrey actually had no one to name as a participator. Sure, he knew lots of famous people, but clearly they didn't play along because he didn't like to play along. He didn't want company in these. Those secrets just never hold. There were never sex parties in Jeffrey's world. He was too grubby and shy for an orgy or anything as a joint mission like that. In prison, he'd been suspected of attempted suicide before the night of his death. Perhaps he was trying out the mechanism. And he told a prison shrink he wasn't suicidal, and that he was a coward who didn't like pain. He didn't like it, he loved it, by one account. And he said he had plenty to live for. He didn't want to go back on suicide watch. That was the real thing. He was planning his own death. His actions demonstrate that. He put up a cover of acceptance. He asked another inmate who was the best cook on 11 North, trying to seem chatty, and that refers to the Metropolitan Correction Center in Manhattan. It has 12 stories, and Jeffrey was in the North section on 11. Yet that dark, dank, and dirty cell with a constantly running toilet would make anyone feel suicidal. He asked other detainees what prison life would be like. Oddly enough, he'd been in prison before, so why would he be asking that? It was just cover and smokescreen. But he knew something of prison, but not this real prison. And he didn't like what he heard. I'm told he sat in a corner and held his ears. He wanted the noise to stop, and using a bedsheet with his waiter's leverage, shut out his new world sounds forever. Only the day before, his lawyers had revealed 2,000 pages of documents that would later form much of the case against Ghislaine Maxwell, and by the way, including a receipt for a book called Training with Miss Abernathy, a workbook for erotic slaves. Available on Amazon then. Supposedly a classic erotic fiction for any pathetic grot's library. Here, even his dirty books were feeble. I can assure you that no serious sicko keeps such fluff on his bookshelf, or gurney tote bag in this case. Jeffrey might have been an autistic mathematical financial wizard, though I think he was more a card-counting sum carrier whose social awkwardness somehow made him merely credible when seeming truthful to gullible investors. But in reality, Epstein was sexually childish. He never married, had no capacity for the deep personal mutual enmeshment that most consider adult sex. His interest in young girls was that they would not respond as a woman would not demand manly passion. From my jungle-clearing observation in prisons, I know more than I would care to know about real child molesters. Jeffrey was far from that special beast. And he could have bought himself any number of adult look-like-I'm-14-year-old prostitutes and physically matched to his regressive desires. But in that, there would have been a problem too. Those actresses would know all the tricks, and he was too shy to risk being mocked by a sexual professional for his boyish, near-infantile predilections. And he was ashamed of his willy, a pear-shaped dick he thought deformed. It appeared that way from what I've seen of it. Ugly-looking thing. Yet he had a half-wit's priapic desire for frequent sex. It rarely went beyond masturbation. No wonder the girls today shudder at their memories. For a man who could afford perfect performers, he was too sexually retarded to climb out of the teenager's car seat. And what are the girls, the self-proclaimed tragic victims of Epstein's bestiality? I can't know. Yet I know this. Almost everyone's first sexual encounter occurs in the early teenage years, and that most of our first sexual experiences are a combination of awful, entirely disappointing, alarming, and confusingly brief, even painful. I remember at 14 being quite painfully clawed by a glamorous woman of 32 with gin and cigarettes on her breath. Yet I thank her for being part of my education. No one gets off lightly when it comes to practical sex education. And it's worse for girls. The only grace is that they're not knowing that the worst is yet to come with adulthood. Those we know of who made their entry into Jeffrey's sordid little sessions were early adventurer types. Curious, naturally, yes. Seekers, though, of the adult world. They were late in their lives to see themselves as damaged. They certainly did not see themselves traumatized at the time. Virginia Giffrey, proclaimed victim, says that when she was 18, she brought Carolyn X, Carolyn doesn't want to give her name, for what she calls sexualized massages. I presume that's a feeble code for more handjobs. And that was when Carolyn was 14. Oh, before you missed up, she'd been driven to the session by her boyfriend, again being told she'd get paid. The money was as low rent as the sex, $300 per massage, and it took puny Jeffrey 45 minutes face down with embarrassment on the table to find the courage to flip over for his happy ending. There's more at stake here now than $300. I guess $3 million plus each at least. Would such experiences, though, leave scars on a young mind? Perhaps the fading scars of growing up with disappointment. The truth of these accusations, as reported, amount to a puny expose of an already thin story. And what's going on in the world that makes so much of so little? I can't count the number of girlfriends who've told me of their awful uncle, stories of pervert teachers, or even creepy boyfriend stories, far, far worse, and it didn't destroy them. Are these all special cases? In the Maxwell trial, the witnesses decided it should. What I see is this. Most of the girls had dreams of meeting some rich, sophisticated playboy. They would skip into that world and be charmed, given lavish gifts, and become a princess. To them, with a teenager's imagination, If there might be sex, then it would be wonderful princess sex. Instead, they found a grubby little mutant jerking himself off. Instead of being groomed for the catwalk in Paris, they were groomed for nothing. Dumped when they lost their naivete in giving cab fare to Poughkeepsie or someplace. That insult, that dumping, must be paid for. I can't help but think of some things in the trial of Ron Jeremy, one of the unaccountably famous porn stars of the 1980s. He was always ugly and flabby with that trainee policeman's mustache. He had, it seems, though, one asset, an utterly reliable knob, needing less time using the sideshow fluffers to complete his over 2,000 porn movies. They call it the adult film industry these days. It sounds more legit, doesn't it? Jeremy looks 100 times worse in an orange jumpsuit and that paper-thin, long, streaky hair. His fellow performers from the old days have now brought charges against him. Ginger Banks started a campaign accusing him of rape. She sanitized her appearance for her videos, but actually, to me, looked rather in character still. Towner wanted to meet Ron to monetize her sexual career.
There have been allegations of rape and sexual assault against Ron Jeremy that go back as far as August 2003. How does Ron Jeremy, just being a porn star, give him the right to assault these females?
I came to LA and one of my friends was doing some kind of radio show. It's like, I'm doing a radio show. If you would like to come, Ron Jeremy's gonna be on it. And this would be a great opportunity for you to get in porn. So I was like, oh my God, that's so cool. Great. Yeah. Yeah, he definitely put his penis in my vagina without my consent. And then my friend's like filming it and like encouraging me to do it. I'm like, it was just kind of fucked. Like now when I think about it, at the time I didn't give a shit. And I was like,
tons of videos of him touching women in public. And it wasn't clear how they felt about it.
What was the emotion of regret there? A wave of shame? Was the trade not as she'd hoped? Did the porn industry not live up to its reputation? That aside, certainly, consent is absolute. The most notorious rent boy or girl in Los Angeles is perfectly entitled to reject customer number 666 without giving any reason at all. So, is it assault or rape? Now, in law, rape has bad form, a dodgy history. It goes back to the days of setting a gold price, a money price, a value of owned property, the wife, daughter, or slave, that may become damaged goods by being soiled. Perhaps simply stripping down, taking away the woman as chattel elements from the rape laws to those new style rape laws which seem to just drift into discussions on penetration. Neither of these things is a solution. Neither is good enough, is it? Perhaps we should dump the whole history and keep the crime as assault to whichever degree the action reveals. Simplicity. But I digress. Back now to the Ghislaine Maxwell case. It's a trap of a case because the degree of badness for Ghislaine depends on the degree of badness for Jeffrey. She's being judged in reflection of him. So you have to think, what sort of criminal is he? Low level, pathetic, yes. But what degree of damage did he do? In law, none of the girls had been over 18 and therefore free to do what they want. Some were 17, so had been ruled out due to state or country laws that applied to them. There's big distinctions in this silly case. Now, but is it making any difference to that jury? I doubt it. What sort of jail sentence would Epstein have received in any court these days? Certainly, having sex with a minor in the United States would often result in jail time. In fact, Epstein had served 30 months, years back it was, 2008. And of course he was written up in the perverts register as well. Worked 6 days a week while he was in the joint. Actually, outside of the prison, he was on license. Jeffrey had some influence in his affairs in those days. He must have had confidence. But the swing in public manner and style has swept away deal-making, even for the rich. In the new case, had he lived, the prosecution would say he stole the girl's innocence, at least that. Yet there's something artificial about the sex crimes here that are not attacks using violence or intimidation. They're kind of statutory. And the girl said that they did it for the money. So the same act of sex can be legal in one state, yet a felony in another. But I feel people out there in TV land are not following these distinctions. Perhaps the jury's the same. There is plenty of scope for defense lawyers to argue that the case is not so serious. It was not an act of violence, and consenting, yet the numbers would go against him. The law does not permit consent, and with so many girls, he became indefensible. Looking at the girls today, they seem to have survived, and I must admit they didn't think much of at the time of what they were doing. They looked like the housewives of Little St. James. You know, I like to play the devil's advocate just as an exercise quite often. You know, the way we imagine ourselves as one of the German army commanders in Stalingrad in 1943. Was there any way to survive? Yet even the most inventive devil's lawyer could not, I think, find a way for Jeffrey Epstein to survive in 2020. Now, so how evil does this make Ghislaine Maxwell? I expect her to be found guilty of a few of the counts and to be sentenced to something that amounts to less than 10 years. Is this justice? I think not. Should she be jailed at all? In a trial like that? The trial has been a tired circus of insignificant trivia. For theatrical reasons, even the massage trolley was dragged into court. That green thing. However, I do wonder why Ghislaine had such sympathy and energy to cater to Epstein's pathetic wishes. She was the youngest of 9 children to Robert Maxwell, a Czechoslovak-born British media baron who was quite a trickster himself. She took a degree in modern history at Oxford and worked for her dad. In 1991, Robert Maxwell's body was found floating in the Caribbean Sea near his yacht called the Lady Ghislaine. And Ghislaine herself, she said of her father's death, he did not commit suicide. That was just not consistent with his character. I think he was murdered. At the time, over £440 million in pension funds from the Mirror Group newspapers had been redirected by Ghislaine's father. And later, 2 of her brothers faced fraud charges, but the charges didn't stick. She has had a good, but not extraordinarily rich, trust fund to support her. Listen, here's a little of Ghislaine speaking. It doesn't matter what the content she's talking about. Protecting the ocean in a TEDx talk. I use these clips simply to gift style and character. I'll have some tips on what to look for when you're looking for people's mannerisms when speaking in the How to Become a Master Criminal series on this channel.
So I created the Terramar Project, which is this digital platform, and create symbols such as I think we can all understand, this is I love the ocean. Now, each and every one of you in this room has a network. You are on Twitter, you're on Facebook, and this is the new way to communicate. The way that we normally think about the commons is the tragedy of the commons, if we even think about it at all, but I think we have a unique and amazing opportunity today to turn what has always been known as the tragedy of the commons into the first success of the commons, and that's because of each and every one of you in this room has the power and the ability to change the way that we think about this world and our oceans and the part that you own, because you own it. It is yours, and you do have a decision to make.
And this Ghislaine, nervy, driven, a voice that's hard to locate as an accent, even if you grew up in Britain. No cruelty that I can see. Some obvious ruthlessness, or is that defensiveness? Her charity, the Terramar, Terramar Project? Oh, I know it wasn't. It wasn't just a scam. There were better scammers than that when they came to scamming. It's no longer afloat, the old Terramar Project. It has sunk. I do not think money was part of any reason for her supporting Epstein's risky behavior. Ghislaine, a tragic figure in her own way, suffered loss and insecurity all her life. She lost her 15-year-old brother, Michael, in a car accident, and that left him in a coma for a long time before his death. Her father's death was a shock, of course, and added to her already anorexic nervousness. She had to step around Dad's mercurial business life as well. Now, as controlling Chatelaine in the Epstein bubble, she found the security her own family life had muddled. That security proved to be an illusion, with the worst possible outcome for a woman of means. In July 2020, the FBI confirmed her location with a device known as Stingray, a portable cell phone repeater that catches the pings with the identifying IMSI number of phone users. Before Christmas, Ghislaine's defense team will bring in an expert in false memories. She has a very competent group, and I'm sure many counts will be shredded. Unfortunately for her, not all. But what is all this about? I mean, why am I here doing this, and what is all the interest? Why has there been so much airtime and fascination in a case about, what, the facilitator of a dead man? A dead man whose crimes in the great history of humanity's dark deeds against one another are almost trivial. Trivial, I hear you say, pointing fingers, dark comments being levelled. Evil Epstein, the deflower of virgins, how dare you trivialise what he did, the beast who tore the childhood from so many. My childhood was all ponies and Cinderella at 15 until Jeffrey abused me, says one litigant seeking damages. Yes, well, she too says she went for the money in the first place. And I'm not sure that any 15-year-old girl at a high school talking about ponies and Cinderella as she neared her senior year would be well accepted in a Florida high school in any decade. A bit old for that, in her own world. And that's the point. We are watching this pageant because it makes good TV, acceptable TV. It has the villains and the innocents. It has the rich and famous. It has mysterious death and great courtroom performances. It is 21st century family entertainment of perfection. Crimes not too awful, for in reality we turn without speaking at those real crimes. These last weeks in Britain alone, 2-3 bad murder convictions of young women who themselves tortured babies and toddlers to death. No, that's too damn real. It doesn't fit. No one understands. Why? No, better to hang the rich. Crucify the corpse of a dead man. That's what we do. Point to dark conspiracies. Light the stage. Lock up nasty auntie. Damn bitch had all that upbringing and money and all. About time for those kind. That's the circus we want for the pandemic Christmas. So, from your most humble ringmaster, that's the kind of reality I'll give today. Santa's green trolley. Yes, me too. You know the warnings you get for films? They say violence, nudity, swearing. Well, they call it foul language. Even a damn cigarette. Somebody smokes one. Even one of his own making. What's my defense? It's all natural. Nothing's natural. Since the Big Bang, everything's going to be natural. And why am I nervous? It's the James Webb fucking telescope going up. You know, even for its sunshade, something like 390 actuators have to all work in sync. And if they don't, it's screwed. Well, it'll heat up, it'll go wrong, it'll warp. People have been working on that 25 years, their whole lives, virtually.